Today we are engaged in a final all-out battle between communistic atheism and Christianity. The modern champions of communism have selected this at the time. And ladies and gentlemen, the chips are down. They are truly down. Joseph McCarthy.
Oh.
Oh, that was
nice.
That was terrible. Okay, so anyways, hey folks, good people, person out there in podcastavia, well, you're listening to The Loathsome Things, a horror movie podcast where we discuss horror movies. Okay. And my name is John. With me as always is Josh, my lovely co-host. Josh, how fareth thee?
Oh, I fareth somewhat well. Podcastavia?
Yeah, it's a small town.
You're right. It's somewhere in California.
Yeah. It's close to Santa Mira.
Oh, yeah, that Bing real bong. Place yep. in California. Yeah. Yeah, I'm doing okay. I am getting I'm getting oral surgery tomorrow. So right now I am in a wee of pain, but it's going to be okay because I actually have dental insurance for like the first time in forever. So it's nice.
Yeah, that's good. Gonna have an extraction, are you?
I'm gonna have a root canal. Oh. They're gonna drill into me like an oil rig.
Oh, good time. I had an extraction earlier this year and have a nice gap in the back of my teeth where there's no molar. because I was supposed to have a root canal. It had already had a cap on it, a crown, and it went bad underneath, so I was going to have a root canal and then have it re-crowned. It was going to cost me, like, with insurance, like $3,000.
Jesus, no.
So I was like, nah, that's not happening.
Yeah, that is the thing about dental insurance that is just really great and really tells you a lot about capitalism. There's a maximum that it'll pay out.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like the opposite of medical insurance where, all right, after you've paid this much, then we'll just cover the rest of it, basically, except for like copays or whatever. But with dental insurance, it's like, yeah, once you hit this much, you're on your own.
Yeah, you're done. It was nice knowing you.
Yeah, good luck, guy.
Thanks for all the money.
Which is why I didn't have dental insurance or go see a dentist for such a long time.
Yeah, it's great. It's a mess. Capitalism.
Yeah.
Capitalism can eat my shorts.
Yeah, it's not the... I don't know if there are better ones out there for a country of our magnitude, but I don't think puritanical capitalism is necessarily the right.
Well, it's interesting that we're discussing this given the subject matter of the film that we have chosen to discuss. Josh, what film are we discussing this fine day? I don't know.
On this very fine early April afternoon, John and I are discussing Don Siegel's original, not adaptation of anything else at all, Invasion of the Body Snatchers.
That was an adaptation of the novel.
Shh! It's an original story!
Yes, part of what turned out to be three films.
Four.
Well, four, I guess, is because there's a sequel or something.
There's this one, the original. There's the 1978 film directed by Philip Kaufman. The 1993 film, Body Snatchers, directed by Abel Ferrara. And then, of course, the 2007 film, The Invasion, starring Nicole Kidman and Daniel Craig, directed by Oliver Hirschbagel. And,
wow.
And it looks really, really bad.
And we're not doing that one, right?
I don't want to.
Yeah.
If there's like a super high demand, they're like, do another one, then we might think about it. But it's kind of like with Carrie. We're like, maybe after all three Carries, we'll come back around to Carrie 2, the shirking of responsibilities. and then we didn't. I think that's going to be the invasion for us.
Yeah. Well, I guess if we hear back from our fan, then we'll see. We'll see what the fan says.
Yeah, maybe Ramon is a big Nicole Kidman fan.
Ramon. Well, I guess we have two fans. We've got Ramon, yeah. and occasionally Ron, and, yeah. And then we have our fan that we don't actually know.
Fan numero tres.
Yeah, whose name escapes me at the moment. And then there's that person that... There's a few people. And then there's a few people! And then, of course, Taiwan.
Taiwan. Yes, yeah. The entire nation of Taiwan.
Yes. Correct. Whee!
Ooh, Taiwan on! Yeah, okay.
Yeah, the movie stars Dr... No, no, it doesn't. It stars Kevin, Dr. Kevin McCarthy. No, he's not a doctor, but he plays one on TV. Kevin McCarthy, the actor famous for having the nose you can look up when you're staring at him straight on.
Oh, man. And that chin. That chin like a brick.
Yeah. He's not the most handsome leading man in Hollywood.
But he is distinctive. Like,
he is.
You watch this movie and you're like, where do I know him from? And it turns out that you know him from the movie UHF, the Weird Al Yankovic movie, where he played the bad guy.
Yeah, that's right. He does have a role in the remake. It's not, you know, like, it's not a mage. He's not his role is played by D. South, essentially.
Yeah.
Or at least as the main dude.
And he did reprise his role as Dr. Bunnell in the 2003 film Looney Tunes Back in Action.
That's awesome. I do like Kevin McCarthy, but he definitely has a distinctive look. That's true.
Oh, yeah. And he was in, like, basically one episode of every 50s, 60s, and 70s TV series.
So. Yeah, just like his co-star, Dana Wynter, who plays Becky Driscoll. She was in Airport, and then... every television show ever made.
Yeah, and occasionally went in the credits as Dagmar Wynter.
Whoa!
And then later became, like, a weird journalist. Like, she wrote articles in National Review and Country Living.
Yikes.
Oh. Yeah.
Wow, that's terrifying.
Yeah.
A homemaking right-winger.
And then we've got, of course, the amazing Carolyn Jones, the original Morticia Adams.
Yes.
Here she plays Teddy.
Yes. Also, in a little cameo role, Sam Peckinpah plays a meter reader.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. He's, Sam Peckinpah's, was quite a character, and he went to his death claiming he wrote the screenplay to this movie, for which he's not credited.
Ooh! Oh, no!
Yeah, it's pretty awesome.
Oh, Sam.
Don Siegel made Dirty Harry. He made Escape from Alcatraz. He made this. He made Play Misty for Me with Clint Eastwood. He's made some bangers.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he was like Clint Eastwood's like mentor, and Clint Eastwood even dedicated the movie Unforgiven to him.
Nice.
And he also famously directed Ronald Reagan and John Wayne in both of their final movie roles, in both scenes in which Ronald Reagan's final movie role in which his character died, and John Wayne's final movie role in which his character died.
Oh, was it Coogan's Bluff? Is that the one?
Yeah. No, it was The Shootist.
Oh, The Shootist was the last one.
For John Wayne, and The Killers for Ronald Reagan.
Wow. See? Yeah. See how it all comes around-ish?
See what you can do with a nice jar of jelly beans and a little directing talent?
That's right. Oh, dear God.
Let's see. What else? What other trivia? The frame narrative. The frame narrative around this movie was not originally supposed to be in here. But Allied Artists was like, ooh, this movie's real depressing without something to make it happy. Why don't you give it a frame narrative? And he was like, ooh, that sucks. And they were like, well, you're going to do it.
Well, get used to it. Yeah, it's the good old days. And they haven't changed.
No, not a bit. Not a bit. That's all I got on it. You got anything else?
Yeah, no, McCarthy apparently was like, basically spent the entire shoot running, and it only took 19 days to make the movie, so he basically ran for 19 days, and by the end of the movie where they shoot the final scene, he was so tired that there was a legitimate risk of him getting hit by a car.
Oh, God, yeah. Dude looks real flimsy in that scene.
Yeah, yeah. And they tried to shoot down the Red Scare ties, which was like, come on, guys. That's so obvious. And
I'm going to make an argument against this being a Red Scare movie at
nice,
the end.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah.
One last little bit. There were apparently at some of the theaters on opening day or night, whatever, they had paper mache pods.
Yeah.
With, like, you know, cardboard cutouts of Kevin McCarthy and Dagmar running for their lives.
Dagmar?
That name is great.
Who names their daughter Dagmar? What are you, in a comic strip? Get out of here.
That's right. That's about it. Oh, man. Good times.
So Don Siegel was famous for being kind of an asshole director, not to his actors, but to like in his practices. Like,
yeah.
He would sneak onto movie sets. Like, part of his tight recording schedule was they worked through the night, basically.
Yeah.
And he would sneak onto the big studio's movie sets and film at night whenever no one was there, and then get out of there before security found them.
Nice.
Yeah.
I love the guerrilla filmmaking in Hollywood.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Yeah, it's good. All right. Anything else? Do we need to warn? There's a little bit that it deals with Crapgras delusion, which is a really, really terrifying actual ailment that people suffer from, where they think that the people around them, especially people that they love around them, have been replaced with falsehoods. So if that's not your deal, then just come back in May, I guess.
Yeah, when we're done covering those movies, and, you know, then maybe, and good luck on your treatment, by the way, for Mardi Gras delusion.
Yeah. Is it pronounced something different?
I have no idea. I never heard of it until I read about it.
No, it's like Capgrass. It can't be Capgrass.
Yes. Capgrass delusion.
Crapgras. All right, so we're going to dive right on into it. It begins with the frame narrative. A psychologist is assessing Dr. Miles Bunnell for craziness. It turns out that when Miles returned home to beautiful Santa Mira, something was different. Everyone in town had needed to see the doctor while he was away. Miles saw the Grimaldi boy running away from his mother in a panic. The Grimaldi's vegetable stand is a mess, though usually it is the best vegetable stand in the whole wide road. Becky shows up wearing what can only be described as a gift bag, and the music implies that she is, in fact, very beautiful.
Yes.
The next day, the Grimaldi boy doesn't think his mom is really his mom. Becky's cousin doesn't think Uncle Ira is really Uncle Ira. They have all of the memories of the person, but not the same actual person inside, according to these freaks of nature. Dr. Kaufman, the town psychiatrist, has seen a dozen patients in the last week, all with the same condition. Becky and Miles are seen kissing, and it establishes that Miles can identify Becky by her sweet, sweet kisses.
Aww.
Before Miles and Becky get down to some pre-doing it cocktails, they're summoned away to the Belichick house.
So Bill Belichick comes out with Tom Brady, and wait, hold on, my
football
bad.
Football references that everyone will get.
Especially in Taiwan. Oh my God. Okay, so anyways, yeah. So the gang shows up at Jack's house, Jack and Teddy's house, and they direct Dr. Miles over to the pool table where there's a... he pulls back the cover and there's a body laying there that is kind of like a rubberized, kind of looks like Jack, but not quite Jack. The music is extremely dramatic. They take its fingerprints, which are basically just a bunch of ink blobs, so it has no fingerprints, and then it's time to drink booze. So they go to the little bar, and they start drinking a lot and kind of chatting about it. And, you know, there's this theory that Jack and, or his lady has, I should say, Teddy, or Morticia, as I call her, of course, that Jack is a copy of some sort, you know, because, I mean, that's whatever. Then there's a bunch of talk about mass hysteria and how, you know, people become hysterical en masse.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, anyways, so they have that little talk, and then Miles leaves, telling Jack to call the doctor in the morning, or if anything changes overnight, call me with updates. So, in reference, I'm like looking back on that. Basically, what happens is they have a corpse on the pool table that they found. It looks like Jack, but not really. Why don't you just go ahead and keep him on your pool table all night, and then in the morning call the doctor? It's like, what the fuck?
Him.
And then Miles, we find out that Miles is actually, he's scared. You know, they think, well, I mean, it could be mass hysteria that people are saying that other people don't seem like the people that the people used to be, but now there's a double person people on the pool table made of rubber. So he's a little bit worried. Then he goes back to his place with Becky, or is it her place? It's a place. And yeah, they return to the
place.
And Jack is so worried, he's very concerned. I mean, he's very out of sorts, so he tries to fuck her. And she gives this great line, "That way lies madness." And he's like, "What's wrong with madness?" And her response is, "Madness." So, cock block. That was great.
Yeah. There is a lot of, like, really uncomfortable sexual innuendo from these 1950s white people, which I think is, like, part of my argument that this isn't Red Scare.
Okay, fair enough.
Yeah.
then we discover back at Jack's house that Teddy is she discovers, or she sees that fake Jack moves a little bit. And earlier Jack had cut his hand in a melodramatic overacting scene where he drops a giant decanter full of whiskey on the ground and then slashes his hand open, which made no sense.
Yeah, he cut his hand open on nothing.
Like, yeah, he dropped a decanter which cut his hand open.
Yeah, it was very strange. Lots of things like that in this movie.
Yeah, it was weird. And so the fake Jack now has a bloody palm, so Morticia freaks the fuck out. They call Miles. He calls Dr. Kaufman, who is kind of like, "Yeah, all right, yeah, okay." So he's really worried. Dr. Kaufman's really upset. And then Miles is now worried for Becky because, you know, that's his, how's it going?
Yeah.
So he hops in his car and bouncy drives over to her house in what can only be described as the most bouncy vehicle. Like, those cars are so bouncy.
They really are. All throughout the movie, every car is made on, like, rubber ball wheels. It's awesome.
It's like, Jesus. He senses something's wrong, so he breaks a window and climbs into the basement and starts snooping around and checks in, I guess, a coal bin. I assume that's what that was. And finds a fake Becky. It's just a big box with a lid on it. Fake Becky's in there. He freaks the fuck out. He goes upstairs. Her dad's asleep. Becky is asleep, too. He's having trouble waking her up. So he just picks her up and carries her to his car and leaves. Fuck her dad.
Yeah. Abducts Becky. Never.
Yeah. Not a problem. And who cares about her dad? They're with Jack again. She's awake in her little nightie. So that's very cute. He tells them all what happened. They discover that the fake Jack is now gone. He has left the pool table. And then we get this bullshit about an ice pick. What was that bit? I forget the ice pick bit.
The doctor explains how they might, like, how Miles, a doctor, the psychiatrist, tells Miles, a medical doctor, you could stab someone in the back of the head, at the base of the skull, with an ice pick, kill them, and leave a wound so small that it would be invisible to the naked eye, thus you, a medical doctor, wouldn't notice it, whereas I, a psychiatrist, definitely would.
Yeah, I love how Danny is like he's like the philosopher of the group.
Yeah.
Like he just goes off on this ridiculous rant. It's like, dude, calm down. So, yeah, I called him, what did I call him? Dr. Sartre.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. So they go to Becky's place because he wants to show Danny, you know, that he did actually see this fake Becky. So go ahead, open the thing. Go ahead, open it. Go ahead. So he opens it, and of course she's not there. But what is there is a blanket wrapped up over some shit. And so Dr. Sartre is like, well, you see, you have clearly seen a blanket wrapped around shit. And so your mind made up, like, nobody even questions why there's a blanket wrapped around shit in the coal thing. Or the wood bin. I guess it's wood. I don't know. It doesn't matter.
Or is it a freezer? I don't know what it is.
Yeah, I don't know what the deal is with that. Yeah. Becky's dad shows up. Nick the cop pops in the transom window.
I love that. He's got the gun out and everything.
He's a total ass. He's just like, well, you know, and then he's like, says he's going to take I ought to take you two to jail for leaving a body on the pool table overnight. And it's like, what? Apparently they've found the fake Jack burning somewhere just completely else. And because they found the fake Jack burning somewhere completely else, there's nothing wrong. So everyone is sent home.
Yeah, it's fine.
It's what?
Yeah. I love that Becky's dad just, like, finds three randos trespassing in his basement. Yeah. And then a cop pops in through the window, just his head and his gun.
So great. Back at Dr. Miles's place, he's startled because a gas dude is in the basement.
Yes.
She's like, I just wanted to read your meter by crawling into your basement. So then that kind of brushes over whatever. And then Miles and Becky eat eggs.
Oh, God.
Then we find that Jack and Morticia had stayed over. They wake up. They, you know, Jack is like, if you don't mind, I would like if Teddy and I were able to remain here during the... And then it's so weird. So then there's this lady that he runs into this lady later, Dr. Miles, who he had seen earlier in the movie, and you know, she's just wasn't herself, and she was going to have her, you know, come in so he could check her out. So she comes in, but now she's like, I am fine, Dr. Miles. Nothing is wrong with me. So he's like, oh, well, that's great. Wow. Okay. And then she leaves. And then we see her with her alien dude, like another person who is actually an alien. And they're like, yeah. So anyways, so also in the waiting room, by the way, is Jimmy Grimaldi with his mom. And everything's fine now. Everything's happy. Fine. Mom's back to normal. Everything's great. Yeah.
Back home, Miles finds all of his guests are hanging out in his backyard. They're just about to grill, waiting for him to come home with the steaks. So while all of this is going on, he also did grocery shopping. Good. And they're hanging out in what is either his backyard or possibly his greenhouse. I don't know what's going on. But then we see, they hear, and we see that there are pods all throughout his greenhouse. They are foaming and popping open in really cool practical effects for the time.
Yeah.
And then there's, like, body-shaped, like, beans inside that are unfolding and, like, continuing to fizz. It's really, really good. And then they just kind of put together that these body snatchers replicate the humans that they're trying to emulate or whatever while the humans are asleep. They realize then by phone calls and such that the cops are in on it. And the only hope is to get, you know, like the National Guard or police officers from other towns because the cops around here are shit in California.
Yeah.
Miles can't bring himself to spear Becky's pod with the pitchfork, but he does manage to spear his own in another really good practical effect. Miles and Becky go to get Nurse Sally. When they get there, they see that the pod council is convened there. They escape, but are chased. The cop guy puts out an APB to detain them, and the entire Santa Mira police force is now engaged in pursuing Miles and Becky. They hide where no one would think to look for them, in his doctor's office, and evade capture throughout the sleepless, stimulant-fueled night of kisses. The next morning, they see the town at the town center distributing pods to be sent to the surrounding towns. And then finally, Jack knocks on the door. They're like, oh, at last, Jack came back. But he's there with everyone else. It turns out they got to Jack. They also got to Teddy. He confronts Becky and Miles. We learn that the seeds are from outer space. They fell from the sky and created the pods. He tells them that they'll be reborn into an untroubled world where everyone is the same. Quote, there's no need for love.
Yeah, no, I'm sure that has nothing to do with the Red Scare.
No.
Everyone's the same. Well, basically, they've discovered now that the whole place is basically taken over by aliens. They may be the only two left, and that obviously this is going to take over the whole country if it hasn't already. So the aliens go wait in the other room for whatever reason, so that Miles and Becky can fall asleep. Becky immediately gets all sob story and is just like, come on. That's pretty much her role in this part of this from here on out for the rest of the movie. It's so bad the way they do play women like that in these movies.
It's real bad.
God. So Miles has this brilliant idea. He's going to make up some weird drug cocktail so he can dose the aliens. We don't know what it is, but he's taking a little bit of medicine from all these different bottles, which is apparently his podicide. And then, you know, then he's like... Nice. Then Becky grows a pair for just like a minute and is like, well, there's two of us, so I can help you. So that happens. And then Miles hides in the cupboard, but before he does, he kicks something over to make the noise. That brings the cops and the other alien folk in, and there's a bunch of needle stabbing going on. Apparently the concoction worked because they're either dead or unconscious, whatever. They're out of the way. Great. That was very exciting. he comes up with this great plan that they're going to run to the highway so that they can warn people on the highway. Which is so weird. But they're not going to be able to get out of there because the whole town is overrun with aliens, so they're going to have to get all wide-eyed and don't show any emotion, and we'll walk through town. Pretty, you know, cool idea. So they walk out the door, and like immediately a dog almost gets hit by a truck and her dumbass screams. It's just like, and of course a cop that they had just been talking to, who was already like questionable, like about them, is like, So he goes to call his other pod folk, and she's just, I like where she's like, I'm sorry. And then they run away. Like they take off.
I'm sorry, Miles.
Then he pulls her aside for a detour up the tallest, like, the largest staircase it's like 500 stairs. Like, what the hell is that?
So yeah.
They get to the top of the stairs, they're completely exhausted, which is hilarious. And then, at the top of the stairs is basically a crest that overlooks a fucking canyon. So they just run into a canyon and just start running across a California canyon, being chased by a single-file line of aliens. Who aren't showing any emotion, but sound very emotional.
Yeah. Hey, yeah, get them. Oh,
yeah. It's like,
hey, they went this way.
Totally. It's like all those sounds are there. It's great.
Yeah.
They hide in a cave, and she starts whining again. And then he tries to find a place to hide, and then he sees, like, the first thing he sees is there's, like, some floorboards over a hole. So they get down under there and straighten the floorboards out. Like, if he found them, why couldn't they find them just as easily? But yeah. they don't. They come running in, like, maybe they went this way. And they go running down over the things, the boards, whatever. And then they leave. Nope, they're not here. Let's go. And so they leave. And now Becky's just, she just can't stay awake. She's just too tired. I mean, just camp. I know that we've been running for 5, maybe 10 minutes, but I just can't stay awake anymore. God, she's fucking annoying.
They do lots of that stuff where it's like two people that are just like rubbing their faces together with their mouths open but not kissing.
Yeah, it's really gross. And then all of a sudden we hear what sounds kind of like Hawaiian music. It's like this with some lady singing over it, and it's really loud. And
that's the most beautiful thing I've ever heard.
It's just, I love that it's the most beautiful thing that she's ever heard, and it's just some song.
It's just some shitty luau song or whatever. And Jack.
Like she's never seen a Disney movie.
Miles, who I keep calling Jack for some reason.
It's fine.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
He looks like a Jack.
He does. Miles decides that, why don't you, who is, you know, can't stay awake to save your fucking life, literally, why don't you stay here in this dark cave while I go investigate this awful music? So he runs over the top of the cave, and right over the top of the cave just happens to be the largest, like, grow farm of pods. Like, just, I thought they were in the middle of nowhere by a cave. Now they're suddenly, you know, like, suddenly they're by, like, the world's largest pod growing station or whatever. I don't know, it's stupid. And the music is just playing over the radio.
Yeah, in a car.
Yeah, it's just some stupid fucking song on the radio.
Yeah, the most beautiful thing she ever heard.
Some bucket of shit on a radio.
On a 1955 pickup truck radio that you just know is good. And it doesn't make any sense because it's pod people that are playing the music. Why are they playing the music?
And do the pods grow better when they listen to bad music?
I bet so.
Oh my God. So he goes back to the cave. Oh, Becky, Oh, you're kind of, sort of awake, but not really, and he carries her away. She's the most tired woman that's ever lived. And then, oh, guess what? She comes to, she's an alien. Somehow she magically fell asleep and turned into an alien without a pod, just completely broke all the rules that have been established through the film, just so that we can be scared by the unscary reveal that she's a pod lady. Okay.
Yeah.
And then more mountainous chasing.
Yeah.
But this time with
he's
narration.
Over here. Yes.
And then I thought that we should run through the mountains some more. And like, then they come across the busiest highway I've ever seen in my life, considering they're supposed to be out in rural California. It's just like cars everywhere. And he decides he's going to warn these people because, you know, he doesn't even know if they're pod people or not. So he's running through traffic trying to warn people. And they're all like, get out of the road, you maniac. And he climbs up on the back of a truck full of pods, of course. And then he freaks out, almost gets run over, runs around in traffic a little bit more. It's absolutely insane. They're here already. You're next. He's like screaming at the top of his lungs. I had to turn this volume down at that part, actually. And then we get the, we're back to the framing. He's now in like a doctor's office with a couple dudes, like a cop and a doctor listening to him. And there's some other dudes in the room, and he's explaining his situation while they all just kind of look at him like, And then the two guys, the doctor and the cop, go into the other room to discuss if Miles is actually crazy or maybe he does kind of have a point. You know, they're kind of on the fence about that. And while they're discussing this, they emergency people come rolling in on with this this guy on a gurney, and they tell this ridiculous. He had been hit in traffic. Wow. Okay. Whatever. And they described that there were these pods on a truck coming from Santa Mira. So now these guys believe him. They put out a national alert. Like they just get on the phone and call everybody that's important in the entire country. And then that's the end of the movie, with Jack just moping in the background, all dirty and sweaty. And movie over.
Yeah, I like that it's like some psychologist is like telling police officers to like command the military to do shit.
Call the FBI. Call the White House. Like, what the fuck? Oh, sure. Officer Dudley Spencer from Santa Mira is calling Mr. President. Like, give me a break.
Yeah. And the whole thing with Becky is just infuriating. Mm-hmm. Like, she even says, I went to sleep, Miles, and it happened. And, like, she's still wearing the same clothes, so it's, she didn't, that's not a pod body, it's her body got taken over. He even says, their bodies were now hosts harboring an alien form of life. It's like, no, that's not what you did! That's not what was going on!
No, that's not, they were replaced! The body was like, basically, they don't even really explain it. You go to sleep and just vanish, apparently, and just turn into this pod thing, just spits out a different version of you, and you magically vanish.
Yeah.
Unless you're Becky, in which case you just turn into a pod because you went to sleep.
Yeah.
Which
doesn't make sense.
It's like, what? Okay, so what? So this dust, this space dust, or, you know, alien space seeds only landed in Santa Mira, California? It makes no sense.
Yeah.
But they try really hard to make it end on a positive note, as if he somehow saved humanity.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, wow. Is it worth saving?
Yeah, 1950s movies. It's very similar to The Thing from Another Planet, where at the end it was like, well, thank God there were white men around.
My God, there wasn't a single person of any color other than sheer white in this movie.
Yeah.
Everybody was white as can be in this movie. You know, it's funny thing about this movie, and it's something that I've been thinking a lot about lately because I've been writing this fucking book, how everything happens in the United States. It's always in the United States because it's just, that's where these movies are made, so that must be where everything happens.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, you can't have the invasion of the body snatchers that just happens to take place in Uganda, because then you'd have to learn about Uganda and film somewhere that looked like Uganda, or maybe go there or whatever. So I just put it in the U.S. It's fine.
Yeah. Yeah, and not just in the U.S., but, like, if you watch Mystery Science Theater 3000, about half of the movies that they watch are set in the very same desert and stairs as the one at the end of this movie. Like, Laser Blast, Mac and Me, it's just the same spot.
It's great. I mean, it really, when they refer to it as the film industry, that's exactly what it is. It was just an industry, just pumping movies out.
Yeah. Yeah, just churning out the crud.
And this one is pretty good. I mean, it's got some cool stuff, and I do like it as much as we slagged it.
Oh, yeah.
It's very much, you know, a movie of its time, and that's not my time. It's before my time. So, you know, just like, you know, anything that happens before you're around is just like this weird fantasy world that doesn't really exist, but you're told it does. And you know, then you see these depictions of it in film. And particularly in the 50s, verite was not a very popular idea. You know, they worried about things like, but if the pods break out and they're naked, then children can't see the movie. You know, like, things like that that are completely irrelevant. You know, by the 70s, you know, as we'll discuss, you know, it reflects the 70s culture, you know, in its own way, and does a pretty good job of it. But, yeah, this movie was fun. I enjoyed it. It's just kind of, I mean, it almost feels like a made for TV movie, to be honest. But the big saving grace for me is the special effects. They're not very used very often. They're just used in a few shots. The pods look ridiculous, but when they open and do the whole latex foamy thing, they look great.
They look really good, yeah.
It was really well done. Like, even the sound effects were great. That weird, like, the fizzy sound of the foam popping. And
yeah.
Yeah. Those weird latex bladders filling up and plopping on the ground. It was like, man, this is really good.
Yeah, that was really good. And whenever it shows, like, the close-up on the pod duplicate of him, and we see his face, but it has that obvious, like, clay foam chest, mm-hmm. And it's, like, close-up in, and you're like, oh, wow, yeah, that does look like him. And then just from off-screen, the pitchfork comes down and through the chest. You're like, oh, shit, wow, I was not expecting that.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I really like the effects. The effects really sell it, and the idea is a cool idea. I mean, it's one of those movies where, you know, they're kind of one of the first to really, you know, put that idea into the mainstream, and it's been done so many times now. It's kind of hard to keep in mind that this was kind of where it started, you know. But having said all that, I enjoyed the movie. I mean, did you enjoy it?
Oh, I loved it. I thought it was great. I think the cinematography was really interesting, especially in that scene in the greenhouse where at that scene, whenever it you first see the pods in the greenhouse, the camera is low and looking up at an angle and like moving around weird. And it's really good. And I think it's when Jack has the pitchfork and he's like crouching low and like just sneaking up on the pods, and you can see, even though it's black and white, you can see the light glinting off of the tines of the pitchfork. It's like really good. And then of course there's lots of stuff that's just very 50s movie. This guy did go on to direct two episodes of the original run of The Twilight Zone. So, like, it makes sense that it would feel that way. But, you know, some of it's cheesy and of its time, but some of it is, like, really groundbreaking. And one of the things that I thought was groundbreaking, and I guess I'll roll this into my idea about it not being Red Scare, is the two main characters are promiscuous. Like, I think just briefly they mentioned that she's married and or maybe divorced, I don't know, but like,
yeah, both of them, yeah,
yeah, like they haven't seen each other in 5 years. They are not together, and mm-mm. and they are just getting, both of them are real ready to just do it, and that's not typical Red Scare behavior. I think what's going on in this movie, because you get these things like there's no need for love and stuff like that. The director, Don Siegel, was not a conservative dude. He was like his movie, Riot in Cell Block, whatever, was a prison reform movie. Mm-hmm. And this movie is talking about sameness, like this, it's like people are trying to all behave the same, and there's that one in there about being reborn into an untroubled world where everyone's the same.
Right.
I think this is not a scare about communists. I think it's playing with the Red Scare, but I think it's actually talking about the fright of 1950s culture where everyone's driving the same car. Everyone's, you know, like you have to get the TV. Your neighbor's got the TV. Your neighbor's got a microwave oven, whatever it was. I think this was him talking about that fear of that like strong sameness and everyone rallying behind these like creepy, superficial, like social constructs.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, I could see that. That totally makes sense. I mean, it's, yeah, that's the era of mass production, that post-war boom where, you know, everybody acted like everything was great, but then now there was this threat of oblivion. And that's obviously, that's where that the Red Scare thing comes from. And, you know, maybe it wasn't, yeah, I guess when you put it like that, I totally agree with that. And I guess what I would say is they are definitely playing off of this thing in the culture where we are, you know, supposed to believe that this other, you know, thing is like our, you know, and that, because, yeah, you're right, it doesn't really mesh with the idea that, you know, we don't think of people in Russia as, you know, being emotionless drones. I mean, we drones maybe, I don't know, but we think of them as like, yeah, you know, well, you know, it depends, I guess. Maybe back in the 50s, they thought of them as uneducated peasants or something, that were all, you know, being being dictated to by some autocrat. I don't know. But yeah, that's an interesting way of looking at it, because, you know, it totally does fit in with like the whole suburban uniformity. You know, that was really the era where everybody had to have this, you know, TV dinners were out, and, you know, moms were, you know, all this technology was being, you know, created so that moms could run a clean house and all this stuff.
And all throughout the movie, we keep getting these little things like, oh yeah, there's the Grimaldi boy, and oh, you know, everyone has a role to play in the society, and there's a set of expectations, and they even play with it later whenever they're hiding in the doctor's office and they're overlooking the town center. He's talking about, oh yeah, there's that family just like they normally would be. And there's that family just like they would normally be. But you can see that they're waiting at the bus stop, even though another bus doesn't come for 2 hours, because there must be outsiders here. And so they're putting on a display. And so it's like, there's these set expectations of everyone doing the same thing at the right times, and if anything's not like that, then that means that there's something horrifically wrong. But these two main characters aren't super conforming. Like, they travel away from the town. He just came back from a trip. She mm-hmm. spent time in England, which I can't imagine 1950s America was like, yeah, go spend time in England. And yeah, it's just it's super interesting. But, you know, it has its problems. I also, like, that plot hole with Becky at the end, that really pisses me off. It makes me
so mad.
Yeah,
that plot hole is bad. Obviously, I can't say that you can forgive it for the way they treat the women, but it's just very much a part of its time. But as far as, like, the half-baked plot hole, that does not necessarily have to be very much a part of its time. It's just a half-baked fucking plot hole, you know? There's other issues I had, you know, kind of with just the whole conceit. I mean, you know, why does this alien life form, that they're perfectly happy to just reside in human bodies? I mean, why? And why would they, I guess they're pretending to act like humans, but at the same time, they basically do act like humans. They're just unemotional. And that's kind of their point, you know, like, well, you know, we don't have to have emotions, you know, we don't have to worry about love. I mean, love never works and all this stuff. And it's like, okay, well, that's great, whatever. And like, yeah, like his whole thing is, yeah, I don't want to be like that. I'd rather take the risk of, you know, the risks that come with actually having emotions. And okay, that's great. But at the same time, they don't do a great job of kind of defining what the aliens are, but I guess it doesn't really matter. It's just kind of this idea that they can play this story off of.
Yeah.
I mean, as far as the Red Scare thing goes, though, I think it's like, you know, this idea that there's this insidious invader and that they look just like us, at least, you know, in that form they do. You know, and they in so many ways, they basically are like us, but they aren't. There's something different. There's something alien, and they're dangerous. And at the time, there was this idea, particularly in Hollywood, you know, that the whole industry was being taken over by this communist element, because there were a lot of communists in Hollywood at the time. And, you know, that was actually kind of a thing for a while. But then anybody was, you know, like everybody was accused of being a communist after that. So, you know, it was just silly. But yeah, I don't know. It's a good movie, though. I really did enjoy it.
Yeah, yeah. No, this movie came out at a time when they were like, there were lists of people like can't work with these people. Right. They're a communist.
Yeah.
And so part of this was that this was done through one of those little indie production companies off to the side, not like the big production companies that had to adhere to a certain set of standards, right, because otherwise the government would come after them. This was like a little like pirate movie company, which is fucking awesome.
That is cool.
Yeah, I think part of that ambiguity is to like kind of slide under the radar, be like, oh, see, we made a Red Scare movie, it's fine.
Yeah,
we're all fine here, how are you?
Yeah, I mean, it's not as overt as like The Thing, which is just, I mean,
yeah,
basically just comes right out and says it. Well, they do come, yes, right out and say it. I mean, then I think about like, well, you know, I know that was just kind of the business at the time, but then Don Siegel makes Reagan and John Wayne's last movie, two of the most like ardent right-wing douchebags in Hollywood history. Yeah, you know,
just the worst
until James Woods came along.
Yeah,
and Scott Baio and Dean Cain and so.
Dean Cain. Oh, why Dean Cain? Why? Oh yeah, and all of those Christian movie actors, like Hercules became like a Christian movie actor guy.
God, that's horrible. What was the young one? His sister was an actress, and he became all super like Tim LaHaye-ish Christian. I forget his name.
Oh, Kirk Cameron.
Kirk Cameron, all the Mr. Battle for Christmas and all that shit.
Oh my God, that movie's so horrible. I don't understand that, but you know, it's whatever. Yeah, no, I can't remember. The Hercules guy was played the evil college professor in God's Not Dead.
Oh my God, so stupid.
Yeah. 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 Wow. So yeah, this movie. All right, so I gave this movie a 4.1 out of 5 Loathsome Things. There's a lot of goodness, a lot of really cool 1950s practical effects, a lot of cool ideas coming through. It has some big flaws, especially that big old plot hole at the end, but also it had such a tremendous impact on horror movies to come. This movie was shocking, and it opened up whole new avenues. Of course, you know, you've got 3 remakes of it and, you know, 1,000 movies with the words pod people in it too. It is very tainted by the era that it was made in, but it also helped progress horror movies into the next era. So I believe it deserves a little bit of extra love for that. What about you, John?
No, I mean, absolutely. I think it definitely did that. It's the kind of framework that just the whole idea of it that can be redone over and over again and doesn't even have to necessarily be a remake. I mean, it's just, you know, which of course that idea is prevalent now, but yeah, I mean, it's definitely like horror royalty. I mean, it really had a profound effect on popular culture. You know, like pod people. People say that all the time. They probably don't even know where it comes from.
You know? Yeah.
But I gave it a 3.85 for basically a lot of the same reasons that you did. I mean, it's hard because I kind of struggle with the time period. And so there's a part of me that's like, you know, would I rate this higher at the time or whatever? Yeah, I probably would, but you know, would I watch horror movies in the 50s? Who knows what I'd be doing then? So
that's true.
You know, so to be fair, I mean, like when I think about its impact on horror overall, for some reason for me, just, and that's what my ratings are always about. Like a big part of my rating is just kind of like my personal, you know, what I get out of the movie. And so for me, it's entertaining. I don't get anything out of it because it's an idea that's been done before. I mean, since, and you know, I'm really glad this movie was there. I'm really glad it was made. Yeah, that plot hole is ridiculous. I really was upset. It really bothered me the way this Becky character was portrayed. But then, you know, like it bothered me the way the men were portrayed. Like, you know, they're portrayed like they were, which is a bunch of bossy douchebags. Everybody thinks they know everything. And they're all idiots. So, I mean, I guess that's accurate. no, I mean, it's a great film. It's had a huge impact on horror. And, yeah, so I gave it a 3.85.
Nice. Yeah.
Yeah.
That is a 7.95 out of 10. I don't think it's going to crack the top 10, but it's a solid entry. And it's going to set the stage for our next 2 episodes, which we'll be judging as movies in their own right, but also comparing to this movie. And I think they like specifically call out the plot hole in the 78 Philip Kaufman movie. Like I think there's like a nod to it and a solution to it or something, but I'm not positive about that. I haven't actually seen the movie in a lot of years. But I did read something about that, so that's going to be interesting.
I saw it last year, but I wasn't scrutinizing it like we will be. Yeah. And I've seen it before, but that was probably the clearest viewing that I've had, you know, because I was, you know, I was older and just have a better take on stuff. But yeah, I don't remember that specifically. I do remember that that movie fucking smokes, though.
I love that movie. What's the deal with mud baths? That's one of the only visuals that I have in my memory from that movie, is that they're just like chilling in hot mud tubs for some reason. And I didn't even remember that Leonard Nimoy was in it.
Oh my God.
Yeah. He's like a self-help guru bad guy or something.
The cast is great. Yeah. And the performances are really good too. And it's disturbing. I mean, it, you know, it's dated too, but you know, it's certainly more, feels more modern than the 56 one. Yeah, sure.
Yeah.
But, you know, that movie did not establish this idea. The 56 one did. So, yeah. You know, really deserves credit for that. Have you seen any good horror stuff?
Oh, shit. I did not prepare for that question. I don't think I watched most of Winnie the Pooh, Blood and Honey.
Nice.
It was really cool at the beginning. It had like a fun little setup and even some fun with the follow through, but then it just turned into now Pooh and Piglet menace and mutilate a sequence of women for another hour and a half or whatever. It's like, okay, at a certain point I was like, I think I'm done. I've got everything that I need out of this.
Very one-dimensional, I guess.
Yeah. It, but good at the onset. What about yourself?
Yeah, well, I mean, there was a couple of horror movies I watched that weren't even worth talking about. They were just terrible. But the one thing I watched that was worth talking about is that show Swarm.
Oh, yeah.
It's original, like, it's made by, well, it was co-created by Donald Glover and a woman whose name escapes me, but she's from Houston.
Oh.
So the original episode takes place in Houston. The main characters are from Houston. It's based around this pop singer who is very clearly meant to be Beyonce.
Not Beyonce.
Yeah. And this girl that is completely obsessed with her, like mega fan, like fanatical. And then basically, you know, some bad things happen to a friend of hers. And she basically becomes a serial killer.
Oh, nice.
And drives around the country. But it's very surreal. It's almost like... like an urban, like, you know, like a black version of like a black take on kind of David Lynch surrealism.
Ooh.
With like a lot of humor and a lot of violence. It's a very good show.
Nice.
So I watched that and fucking loved it. So I highly recommend it.
Nice. I'll have to check that out. Spotify, which I don't pay for, so I get commercials, will not stop advertising that that show to me. It's just like over and over again. I was like, okay, I don't know about this, but now I think I will actually try it. Thank you.
It's really good. Like when I first started it, I just was kind of curious, and I was like ready to turn it off at any moment. But it opens and they're in Houston, so right away I'm like, okay, well, that's kind of cool.
Yeah,
you know, I've been to that city before.
Yeah, don't live there.
Yeah, and. You know, it was great. I loved it.
Nice.
So, anyways, that's about it.
Very cool. Well, I guess then we will let you all get back to your very busy weekends. Let's see. Join us again in 2 weeks when we cover the 1978 film directed by Philip Kaufman, Invasion of the Boomer Snatchers.
Oh, man. Get thine booms.
And do good things, don't do fascism, beware of communists and your neighbors, and shove a bunch of tissues in thine blouse.
And as always, I'm sorry that you all have to die.